Thank you very much. Welcome to CFR's Higher Education Webinar. I'm Irina Faskanis, Vice President of the National Program and Outreach here at CFR. Today's discussion is on the record, and the video and transcript will be available on our website, cfr.org/academic. As always, CFR takes no institutional positions on matters of policy. We are delighted and honored to have Dr. Antonio Flores with us today to discuss the role of Hispanic-serving institutions. Dr. Flores is President and Chief Executive Officer of the Hispanic Association of Colleges and Universities. Established in 1986, HACU represents more than 500 colleges and universities committed to Hispanic higher education success in the United States, Puerto Rico, Latin America, and Europe. During his tenure as president of HACU, the association has nearly tripled its membership and budget, expanded its programs, and improved legislation for Hispanic-serving institutions, and increased federal and private funding for HSIs. He previously served as director of programs and services for the Michigan Higher Education Assistance Authority and the Michigan Higher Education Student Loan Authority. And, you know, needless to say, he's taught at public and private institutions, conducted research and policy studies on higher education issues. And so it really is wonderful to have him with us today to talk about HACU, how HACU is committed to the role of Hispanic serving institutions and to serving underrepresented populations. Obviously, we are very much looking to develop talent for the next generation of foreign policy leaders and really look forward to this conversation. So, Antonio, thank you for being with us. It would be great if you could talk about the Hispanic serving institutions, their role in higher education, and your strategic vision for HACU broadly.
Thank you, Irina, for those very flattering remarks and introduction. And of course, we're delighted to be part of the series here today and talk a little bit about what HSIs are doing and how they can do more of the great work they've been doing for the nation and HACU's role as well in promoting them. And suffice to say that Hispanic-serving institutions have become the backbone of not only Hispanic higher education, but also the American emerging labor force. Because the more than 569 HSIs across the nation enroll the vast majority, more than 5.3 million of them, of underserved students who historically have not been adequately serve in higher education, including Latinos. And it just happens that this population, the Hispanic population, is contributing more than half of all the new workers joining the American labor force today. And that proportion is likely to continue to increase in the years ahead. In addition, of course, they serve scores of African Americans, of Asian Americans, Native Americans, and all Americans. So they are really a microcosm of America's diversity. And for that very reason, going forward, as these populations continue to increase demographically, their representation in the labor force will only continue to grow. The latest Census Bureau report for 2010 to 2020 indicates that more than 51% of all the population growth in the nation is attributed to Hispanics. So there we have it. It's just the reality of the facts. And therefore, HSIs are now the backbone of America's labor force, because obviously the demands of the global economy are such that we need to step up to the plate and really educate at a much higher level and train at a much higher level those underserved populations, particularly Hispanics, so that we can remain competitive in that global economy. And that includes the preparation of top-notch leaders for foreign service careers. And so if we were to summarize how we view HSIs with respect to America's challenges today and opportunities in the future, I would say that there are three dimensions that define HSI vis-a-vis the United States of America and its future in the world. Number one is diversity, and I already alluded to some of that. But that diversity is not just with respect to the fact that they have the most diverse student population on their campuses, but it's also the diversity across types of institutions, because we have community colleges, we have regional universities, and we have research intensive or R1 institutions in the Carnegie classification. So we have within campuses the tremendous diversity, and we have across campuses nationwide institutional diversity as well. And so that's the name of the game. And that's the name of the game for America is diversity. It is the name of the game for the world. It's a very diverse world out there. And so the more attuned those top-notch leaders that were looking to educate in our institutions are with respect to that diversity, the more not only knowledgeable and experienced and sensitive to that diverse reality of the world and of America, the much better leaders they are going to be. And so diversity, again, is that one unavoidable element of our world and of our country. The second, I think, a very important element or dimension of exercise is their dynamism. They are very dynamic institutions that are really doing a magnificent job with fewer resources than the rest of the field. They don't have the deep pockets or big endowments. They don't have the appropriations they need from the federal government they should get. And yet they are excelling at educating those who come to the campuses. Just to give you an idea, Opportunity Insights is the name of an organization that does socioeconomic analysis of graduates from students from colleges across the country. And particularly, they focus on how institutions educate and position and careers those who come from the lowest quintile of entering freshmen to college. And then they look at those who graduate, they graduate and see what proportion of those who came in the lowest quintile moved to the top quintile in terms of earnings. And in the last report I saw, 9 of the 10 top institutions in that regard were Hispanic-serving institutions. 9 of the top 10. And it's not the Ivy League institutions, for sure. It is those institutions that I mentioned that are part of our group of HSIs. And in fact, the number one is Cal State LA in that report that I saw. And so, again, because they are very dynamic, creative, innovative, and resourceful with respect to using what little they have to optimize the educational outcomes of those who come to the campuses. And not just educational outcomes, but career outcomes. Once they are in the workforce, their earnings are higher than those of others from the same lowest quintile when they enter college. So dynamism is the second major component. And I would say deliverance for underserved populations is the other important quality that HSIs represent, because They are obviously serving, for the most part, the majority of their students are first-generation college students. Many of them from immigrant families who are unfamiliar with the educational system and with the intricacies of going through a college education, because they themselves never had that opportunity as parents. So they are a very distinct socioeconomic disadvantage coming from those types of families who are also low income, because to be an HSI, not only does an institution have to have more than 25% of its enrollment being Hispanic, but also they have to show that the majority of their students are Pell Grant eligible. In other words, needy, low income students. And the other criterion is that they have to spend on average per student less than the average of their peer institutions. So they are efficient, very cost effective, and they serve the neediest of our society. So there you have it, diversity, dynamism, and deliverance for the most needy in our society. That's what HSIs are all about. And so they really are in need of much greater support from the federal government, the state governments, and from the corporate community and the philanthropic community. And our association advocates for that to be the case with some success, but not enough. We have been able to increase the appropriations for them from Congress over the years, but they are way behind other cohorts of minority-serving institutions that get much more money per student than HSIs do, despite the fact that they, for instance, they not only educate 67% of all the 3.8 million Hispanics in college today, they also educate three times as many African-Americans as all the HBCUs combined. Let me repeat that. More than three times as many African-Americans go to HSIs as they go to HBCUs. Okay. And more than 42% of all the Asian Americans in college today attend HSIs. They also educate more than twice as many Native Americans as all the tribal college universities put together. And then we have other groups of different national origins who come to our campuses. So they are extremely diverse. And so that's in a nutshell what HSIs are all about. And they've been growing about 30 new HSIs per year, because demographically is how the country is moving. Is more Hispanic young people emerging from high school and going to college than from any other group. And conversely, the non-Hispanic white student enrollment has been declining continually year after year for the last 10 years. Look at the numbers. And that's not going to stop. And major states like California and Texas, for example, the two largest in the nation, more than 50%, about 52, 55% of the K-12 enrollment is Hispanic. If you add the other minority populations, overwhelmingly these states' futures are diverse and Hispanic. And so is the country. Other states are moving in the same direction, whether it is Florida or Illinois or New York, New Jersey. The main states in the nation are moving in that direction. So that's why it's so essential for Congress, the states, corporate America, and philanthropic America to invest in these institutions, much more they have been doing it, because they represent the very future of this nation. To the extent that the new generations of graduates coming out of them are equipped with the right tools to succeed as scientists, as technicians, as professionals in whatever field they choose, our country will thrive. And the opposite will happen if we don't. That's that simple. And so that's what I wanted to just briefly say as an introductory commentary on exercise.
Fantastic. Thank you very much for that. We're going to go to the group now for their questions. You can either raise your hand by clicking on the raise hand icon. When I recognize you, please say who you are and please share your institution and unmute yourself. You can also type your question if you would prefer in the Q&A box. And if you do that, please also share your affiliation so I can read that out as well to give us all context for your question. So I'm going to first go to Manuel Montoya, who has raised his hand.
Thank you very much, Irina. And Dr. Flores, it's a real pleasure to have you on the call. I appreciate all the work that you do for HACU and for Hispanic-Serving Institutions. I'm with the University of New Mexico. I'm an associate professor in international management at UNM. But I also do a lot of work with my cohorts on supporting HSI, our HSI designation. We are a Hispanic-Serving Institution and an R1 institution as well. All of the things you said are really important, and I had a comment and then a question. I think this question of this idea of diversity being the name of the game is not to be underestimated. I think that that the students that go through HSI designated institutions, I think that they have the potential to reshape and recalibrate what we mean when we say we are ambassadorial in the world. And the United States needs to upgrade and change its relational dynamics, political and economic, to include diverse voices that come from the learned and lived experiences of people who traditionally come from first generation families, first generation students, and HSIs are prepped to do that. So my question becomes, you mentioned wanting to track some people into the Foreign Service exam, but what other types of experiences or opportunities do you think are best practices for students that are coming out of HSI to participate in the larger international relations frameworks and careers that that are setting the global agenda?
That's a great question, Professor Montoya. And let me share with you briefly something that I mentioned before we started the webinar to our friends at CFR. And that is that HACU has a very robust national internship program that places upwards of 500 our undergraduates and some of the graduate students with federal agencies, including the State Department. We signed an MOU with the late Secretary Powell, who at that time was very much committed to increasing the number of Latinos in the Foreign Service and other underrepresented populations. And that remains in place, although not with the numbers that we would like to see. And yet there are other agencies that also have a foreign or abroad projection, like the Department of Agriculture, for example, and others that have offices across the world. And so we are very much into helping them find the right talent they need and giving them also as interns experience those agencies and putting them on the right track to become full-fledged employees once they graduate. So that's one thing that we've been doing. We need to do much more of that. I have to accept that the numbers, as impressive as they may sound, are very minute when it comes to the population that we're talking about. And our own association has made it a priority to expand its international reach. And we have, depending on the year, anywhere from 40 to 50 universities across Latin America, the Caribbean, and Spain that are affiliated with us to do precisely what you suggest, which is student mobility and experience abroad. And so, and in both directions, also that they would come to be in the US. And so we have the beginnings, I think, of a major push to make sure that many, many more young people who have kind of an almost organic connection to international affairs, in this case, Latinos, because most of them come from families who immigrated or have roots in other countries, and are really very much culturally adept to international roles. So your point is totally well taken, and you'll see a lot more activity from our end as an association in that regard.
Thank you. I'm going to take the next question from Shoshana Chatfield.
Yes, hello. I wanted to say thank you for such a wonderful presentation and for really exposing me to some of the issues that I wasn't aware of previously. I am the president of the United States Naval War College. And since I've been here over the past 2 years, I have been actively trying to expand our recruiting effort to make our vacancies on our faculty available to members of the community. And yet I'm not seeing any appreciable difference in the applicant pool. And I wonder if you could advise me how I might approach this differently to raise awareness about hiring to these war colleges who have not traditionally had a high representation of faculty who come from the same backgrounds that you described.
Thank you. Thank you for your very timely question, President Chatfield. Let me say that one of the first things that I would suggest is that you join our association as a college. Why would that be helpful to your effort? Because then you will connect with presidents and CEOs of 500 plus community colleges, regional universities, and so forth, and school districts that are also affiliated with us that are defined as Hispanic-Serving school districts, so that even in high school, you will have a presence through our association's outreach to them. And that you also would network with peers of diverse institutions across the country who may have robust pipelines of PhD graduates and others who could fit your own aspirations in terms of getting some of those faculty on your campus, some of those administrators, and some of those students. Because at the end of the day, obviously, you probably want to have a much more diverse student body. And that can come from precisely that opportunity to not only interact, but formally establish relationships with some of those colleges to transfer, for instance, from community colleges or from high schools that we interact with on a regular basis. So that would be one suggestion. We also have in our association a very, very nimble system called Pro Talento. It's online and it's P-R-O, T-A-L-N-T-O, Pro Talento. And then you can go to our website, find it. And we have in that website a very robust database of individuals who are looking for opportunities at different colleges that are already teaching or doing research or both, and are looking for other opportunities. And also we have institutions that are looking for them, and the system basically matches them. And so you can go there and find a gold mine, so to speak, of talent.
Thank you very much. Great question. And we have a couple of written questions in the chat. This one comes from Andrea Purdy, who is an associate professor of Spanish at Colorado State University. We are anticipating reaching HSI status. And in talking to my students, a comment they have made to me is that they don't always feel welcomed all over the university. There are niches, but overall the sense of belonging is not felt. They also commented that while they are beginning to see themselves in classrooms, they don't see themselves in the faculty. What suggestions do you have for universities to make sure that the inclusivity is felt at all levels?
Well, it's similar to the previous question in some regards, because obviously the first thing you want to do as a college or university, it has to be job number one, is to create a climate, a campus climate of support and welcoming feelings for the students, that they feel not only appreciated, but they feel really supported and welcome to the institution. And so the point made is, how can we recruit, or how can we diversify faculty and staff? Well, again, you go, when you want to catch fish, you go fishing where the fish are. And the fish are in some of the HSIs, those that are already more developed institutions. And many of them are regional universities, or R1s or R2s. And those could be a source of talent for institutions like Colorado State that is lacking some of their representation. And of course, I want to insist that please visit Pro Talento, and you may be surprised of how much success you could have in getting people from that database to consider your institution. But of course, faculty and staff who look like the students are essential to create that culture, that campus climate of appreciation and welcoming setting.
Thank you. Let's go next to Rosa Cervantes, who has raised hand. And please unmute yourself and tell us your affiliation.
Good afternoon. Thank you for taking my question. My name is Rosa Isela Cervantes. I'm the director of El Centro La Raza at the University of New Mexico, and also special assistant to the president on Latino affairs. And I'm really interested in what you said, Mr. Flores, about the diversity of students at HSIs, and that we serve three times the amount, if I heard correctly, of African-American students at HSIs than BCUs. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Yeah, okay. And I wanted to see if you could expand a little bit about that, and also maybe think through or talk up to how we can do some coalition building with folks, because I really feel like HSIs are completely underfunded, right? You've stated it, we've heard it, but yet they're so robust and they do so many different things for so many different students. I wonder how we might continue, and we're a member of HACU, but I wonder how we may maybe think through some conversations to really get out the word about that idea that HSIs are that robust, that HSIs do serve large populations of students, and sometimes some of the most neediest students that require more money, right, for the funding. And so I just think that's very interesting. I don't think a whole lot of people know about it or understand that. I had a faculty member at a different institution actually question me because I had read that somewhere. And I think we need to talk more about it. So I'm just wondering your thoughts about coalition building and what else we can do, and how other ways that HACU needs our support to make that happen.
Thank you for your excellent question, Ms. Cervantes. And let me share with you that last week I was in Washington, D.C. most of the week, and met with a number of members of Congress individually, including your great senator, Mr. Lujan. And guess what? There was a lot of good conversation about that point. And I have also talked with a number of African-American members of Congress who didn't know that, and who actually have themselves... and who actually have themselves a significant number of HSIs in their districts. And they didn't know that They didn't have all these exercises in the districts. And so I think the word is getting out there. And more importantly, the appreciation for the fact that these institutions really are very diverse. And not only do they educate the vast majority of Latinos and Latinas, but they also educate a larger number, as you said, of African-Americans and others than the HBCUs, for example. And they didn't know that. And then, so I think the mindset might begin to change, because at the end of the day, the funding and support should be focused on the students. And obviously, if you have the neediest students, you have the more diverse population, but you have the fewest dollars per student coming from Congress, there has to be something wrong there with that equation. So there is an inequity that we are, as an association, trying to remedy, and we need all the help we can get from both our own Latino organizations and HSIs, but also from others, including HBCUs. It's not about reducing funding for them or anything like that. They can and should be getting even more, but HSI shouldn't be treated as second-class institutions. They are not. They are the backbone, again, of America's labor force in terms of training that labor force to be competitive in the global economy. So they have to be treated appropriately and equitably. Basically, it's about equity in terms of funding. And right now, things are not at all equitable. But we're changing that gradually. And thank you for your question.
Gracias.
So we have several written questions. So Sandra Castro, who is Assistant Dean of the Undergraduate Programs at Adelphi University, says, what recommendations do you have for institutions that are striving to become HSIs and preparing for this designation? What internal changes and institutional infrastructure is necessary to truly serve the Latino student body?
I will suggest three things. One is, begin to work more closely with institutions that are already HSIs and that are doing a good job at being HSIs, that are recognized for having, as they say, best practices with respect to being an HSI. And learn from them. Learn how it is that they do what they do well. And begin to then, and the second point is, educate your own leadership at your institution about how they can be much more effective and receptive to their inevitable demographic change and their student population to become an HSI, and how they can make the most of it in terms of student success, and also learning the ropes of how to get grants and funding to improve services for this population. And the third thing that I would recommend very strongly is that, take a very hard look at all your outreach and marketing materials and revamp them accordingly so that you reflect that commitment to diversity and particularly to Latino inclusion in terms of bilingual materials and outreach to families and communities. Because many times the decision about whether to go to college or where to go to college by a student is really influenced very heavily by the family, the parents particularly, and because of the tremendous pressure that many of them have in starting to work to contribute to the family income because they come from low-income families. So working with those families and making them aware of the importance of getting a degree, a college degree, and postponing some of that low income, some of that minimum wage salary that they could get as high school graduates. And working with those families is very important. Working in their language and culture is even more important for some of them.
Great. I think this is a good segue to the next question from Eric Hoffman, who got an upvote. He's the Dean of the Honors College at Miami-Dade College. And his question is, how can we get the Hispanic Latinx students out of their community and expand their aspirations to colleges, universities, and states and areas far from home?
Well, you know, it's an excellent question in the sense that historically, because these are first generation college students for the most part, whose families have not had the opportunity to educate themselves in college. And their expectation is to stay home, especially sometimes it's worse for female students to move away from home. And my suggestion is that you again work with those families as closely as you can to make them aware of the fact that moving away doesn't mean moving away physically doesn't mean moving away from the family otherwise, that they will obviously remain connected to the family. Now with technology, it's even easier, you know, to have FaceTime, to have all kinds of other ways of interacting that were not available just some years ago. And that they obviously need to consider the best options in terms of financial aid and the quality of the education they're going to get and the field of study that they want to pursue. Sometimes all of those things are not available locally, so you have to go where all of those are. And I think once there is a process of education for the family in that regard, they tend to be much more flexible. We experienced some of that with our own national internship program because we place them primarily in the Washington area, but also in other places. And I personally had to intervene sometimes with some families in the language in Spanish to reassure them that the young woman that was going to be placed somewhere else in Washington, D.C. or elsewhere was going to be okay and she was going to come back home after the 10-week experience or 15-week internship. And guess what? After they experienced that, their siblings, they were trailblazers for their siblings and for neighbors and whatnot. Now we don't have that problem, at least with our internship program. We have thousands of applicants, and unfortunately, we can only place about 500 a year and annually. And so it does pay off to invest in working with families closely. And again, it's a generational effect because then younger siblings or relatives will not have that kind of issue going forward.
You had mentioned that you were in DC last week meeting with members of Congress, and we obviously have a new Secretary of Education, Dr. Cardona. Have you seen a shift from the Biden administration in their approach and what they're doing from the federal level to support the HSIs?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's just no question about that. The shift has been dramatic. And this administration and Congress have shifted gears in the direction of investing more than anything else in people, investing in the economy to create more jobs, investing in education to prepare the labor force much better, investing in health to protect people from not just the pandemic, but from other diseases that we experience. And just in general, infrastructure, they just passed that bill in the House, is to improve the lives of people across cities, across states, by improving their infrastructure. It's not just about roads and bridges. It is also about water systems that are decaying and are affecting the health of people. It is about the lack of access to broadband connectivity. It is all of those things that will improve the lives of people. And so there, no question. And HSIs have improved, again, not to the extent that they should be supported, but we are in a much better situation now than we were just a couple of years ago.
Thank you. I'm going to take on Nathan Carter's written question. And then Mike Lenagon, I know you wrote a comment/question in the chat, but I'd love for you just to raise it and speak it, because I'm afraid I might not get it exactly correct. So Nathan Carter from Northern Virginia Community College in the Washington, D.C. metro area. I am the NOVA's Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer. We are an emerging HSI. When we look at our enrollment data here in fall 2021, we see a clear decline in quote-unquote new Hispanic students, both male and female. We wish to discuss this growing issue and recognize what may be the current obstacles or community issues happening right now in the Hispanic community that will help us explain what we see and how we can reach out to the Hispanic community to help address what could be a growing problem across various states. So I think if you could comment on that and how to, you know, to have that discussion.
Well, thank you for that question. It's something that, of course, has been exacerbated by the pandemic, because a lot of our college universities, HSIs and others, did not have the endowments or the money to immediately shift gears in the direction of the technology required to move from in-person to online teaching and learning, and to train faculty and staff to manage all of those new systems. And that's on the institutional side, that there was that kind of reality of not having all of the necessary resources to make that shift immediately and successfully. At the receiving end, you have families and communities that not always have the connectivity to broadband and the devices at home and the space at home to learn online. And so it was a 1-2 punch, institutional and a student were hit very hard. And therefore many of them withdrew. And apart from the fact that when it comes to the rate of infection, hospitalization, and death, Latinos were worse hit than any other population. So much so that during the pandemic, Latinos shrank their life expectancy by 3 years compared to 3 years of Blacks and 0.68 years, or less than a year, for non-Hispanic whites. So you have all of those things, and obviously that means that the students served by these institutions come from those very families that were hardest hit, and their health as well. And so they couldn't go to school. They were trying to survive, and many did not. And so there was a drop in the enrollment, and particularly at community colleges, is where there was the hardest hit with respect to that, just like that community college that is emerging as an HSI. So we are pushing very hard for that to be remedied, not just for the pandemic, but for the long term, because I think hybrid models of teaching and learning will remain in place for the long haul. And we need to make sure that those families, those communities that have been historically underserved and underfunded, get that necessary technology at home to do that type of educational experience. We also need to make sure that the institutions that are suffering the most get the most help to beef up their infrastructure, and not just in terms of technology, but also in terms of expanding classrooms and also creating labs that are very expensive to create for technology or science or engineering types of degrees, which are the most in demand. And in some states, it's even is worse than in others, because a lot of students are homeless. A lot of students are homeless. And in states like California, where we have the largest concentration of Latinos, for example, that problem has been rampant and recognized by the state as a huge priority. So what they need to do is also build affordable housing, even at campuses, so that those students have a place to live in a decent, humane way. And so there are many things that have come to create this perfect storm against populations like low-income Latinos and African-Americans and others.
Thank you. I'm going to ask Mike Lenagon to ask his question live.
Thank you very much, Irina, and it's a pleasure to see you, Dr. Flores. I am Mike Lenagon from Miami-Dade College and truly cherish the empowerment we've enjoyed through the vehicle of HACU. It's been my experience basically with a great deal of labor-intensive and purposeful leadership development to have my scholars, just me as one faculty member, successfully transfer to over 139 colleges and universities in the United States, all of whom required financial support, and almost all of whom were able to avoid loans. This is over a 20-year period. My question is, how might I, as a faculty member, also someone who's labor intensive, be empowered, possibly mediated by HACU, to share basically how to set up my Hispanic students and their families and their relatives for the kind of success my scholars have enjoyed at Princeton, Yale, Cornell, Georgetown, UVA, Duke, UCal, Berkeley, and so on, which when the right combination of chemistry and self-identification occurs, each of my Hispanic Latino scholars basically knows what they uniquely bring and add, as well as what they uniquely can address and engage at each school. I realize I'm just a microcosm and a larger macrocosm, but I'm wondering, does HACU have a role to play that might mediate some education and sharing, not just a book or a strategy, but something that could be shared, including some of what I like to call my all-stars who have enjoyed operating in the context of HACU as a launching pad? Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your very, very important work, Professor Lenagon, and thank you for your very caring teaching and supporting our students, your scholars. And obviously, you have a lot to offer to the academic community as a faculty who cares about their his students not only doing well, but excelling and going to places that perhaps their families never thought of them being able to go. And I think it begins with learning from people like you, what is it you've been doing so well to help those that you have helped to excel? And HACU can be a platform for you to share that. We obviously have annual conferences and other meetings where your expertise and your success can be shared with others to adapt it to their own needs and replicate what you've been doing so well in other places, so that many more can go on to those very selected institutions and others. And of course, I don't know if you've been connecting, I insist on this point, on connecting with families, because many of the Latino families, and maybe in the Miami area is a little different, because a lot of the Cuban and South American families perhaps come from a more middle-class background than in places like Texas or California. And maybe they had already some collegiate experience in their home countries if they immigrated there or whatever. But that helps a lot, okay, when they come with that background. But when they don't, when they are immigrants who come without even a high school diploma, they're from their home countries, and they don't know the language. Their highest expectation is for their kids to just get a high school diploma and start working somewhere. And so to take them to the next level, it takes a lot of work. And it takes a lot of work in terms of making sure that they understand that if their child has the talent, it has the persistence and discipline, et cetera, to go places that they can be very helpful to him or her, ensuring that there is a space at home where they can study, that they do concentrate on their studies, and that they really aim for those places that you mentioned. And don't settle for a second best going to some institution, but make that their goal. I'm going to go to X or Y Ivy League or very selective institution because I have what it takes, but it's going to take a lot of nurturing and support, and the parents can be very careful, even if they don't have an education, by just making sure that their child has the space and the time at home to concentrate on studying, they will go a long ways, that they really let them flourish. And so HACU can be a platform in three different ways. One is allowing individuals like yourself who are excelling in their teaching to share their best practices with others. Secondly, we also, of course, have to recognize that we have some programs already in HACU that are very effective, especially those that are focused on moving critical mass into STEM degrees, and that we're going to emphasize that even more going forward. And thirdly, that we as an association have the ability to influence federal agencies and other and corporations to invest in the kinds of practices that you may be successful at. And I'll give you a couple of examples. We just got a planning grant from NSF, HACU did, and we are almost done with the planning for 1 year because we want to submit a multi-year, multi-million grant to NSF with an emphasis on moving as high as possible to the PhD, in fact, Latinos all the way from community college up to Research One institutions. And we are working on that proposal to be submitted early next year. But we could, I'm sure, learn from what you're doing. And so we can influence agencies to also invest more. We have a new program under NSF for HSIs that you can apply for a grant to expand what you are doing with more students, more parents. And the same thing is true with respect to other agencies. I was just in Washington last week and met with the Undersecretary of the Department of Commerce to discuss a technology program where our institutions will have a role to play. And so we have the role of advocating and influencing agencies and Congress to invest in institutions like yours, Miami-Dade, and professors like you, so that you can do more of that great work you're doing. And so please feel free to send us an email at HACU, and you can send it to my attention. I'll make sure that it finds its way to the right staff in charge of the kinds of programs that you are dealing with effectively, because we do have great staff that follows up on situations like yours.
Fantastic. We will circulate after this an email with some of the resources you've mentioned and the email that we should be sharing, Dr. Flores. So we have another question, and it follows on to Mike's question from Arturo Osorio, who's an associate professor at Rutgers University. Any advice or programs that you know to help connect the parents, the Hispanic Latino students, to the higher education experience? Many of our students are first generation Americans and also first generation college students. This creates a large cultural and experiential gap for parents to bridge on their understanding on what kids are going through and support them. As a result, many of the students have very stressful moments as they navigate away from the family to their college life.
Yeah, excellent question again. And my suggestion is that please send us an email. We have an office in HACU that is designated to promote pre-K-12 and higher education collaboration. The executive director of that office is Jeanette Morales. Jeanette Morales has a team, and they work with clusters or consortia of colleges, universities, and K-12 schools, particularly secondary schools, to move up successfully many more of those underserved students to college and be better prepared to succeed in college. And it's more substantive than just a college visitation thing or admissions officers talking with them, that kind of thing. They actually have early college interventions for high school students so that they actually earn even college credit while they are completing high school for the most advanced students. But they also have opportunity for professors from some of those universities and community colleges to teach as visiting teachers in those high schools where they may not have the resources to hire faculty for advanced courses, for PA courses, and for the courses that are required to be successful, and especially STEM degrees like advanced math, advanced science, and so forth. So that office and our association has been in place for the last 17 years. It was that far back when we first saw that more than half of the battle to succeed in college has to be won in K-12. And it has to be won with families on your side, because first-generation college students do depend largely on families to make decisions after high school. And so please feel free to contact Jeanette Morales or myself on my email at our San Antonio headquarters.
Thank you very much. We are at the end of our time. I just wanted to ask if you could just do really briefly what you're doing internationally to encourage, and we don't have a lot of time, but I don't want to leave without you. You had told me in our pre-call just a little bit. So if you could just give us a wrap up on that, that would be fantastic.
We think of international education not as an appendage, not as a luxury, not as an add-on proposition, but as an integral part of a college education in this case. And that we hope that the vast majority of our young people will have a chance to experience a study abroad. And of course, it's like a big dream, because right now, if you look at the numbers, only about 5 to 7% max of all the 350,000 American students going to study abroad are Latino. And the same number, roughly the same percentage, is with African Americans and others. And conversely, only about maybe 3% of all the students coming from other countries come from Latin America, 1.3% only from Mexico, which is right next door to us. Okay, so that has to change. And it has to change because people who have an international experience obviously expand their horizons and their vision of the world and are more effective, not only professionals, but citizens of the world. And we feel that it's very important for our young people to do that, not as a kind of a luxury or anything like that, but as an integral part of their development as professionals. And so we plan on being even more keen on affecting legislation that will provide more resources for our institutions and international programming, and ourselves as an association be even much more engaged in getting more international institutions to affiliate with us to promote that mobility, that experience, independent of what governments decide to invest or not.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Antonio Flores. This has been really a great discussion. And thanks to everybody for their terrific questions and comments. We really appreciate it. HACU is lucky to have you. We're fortunate to have you leading this great association. As I mentioned, we will send out a link to this webinar as well as some of the resources you mentioned, email addresses and the like. And I'm sure everybody knows it, but it's worth repeating the HACU website, HACU.net. You can follow them on Twitter at HACU News. So go there. You can also follow us at CFR_academic. And please go to CFR.org, foreignaffairs.com, and thinkglobalhealth.org for CFR's resources on international affairs and the like. So I hope you're all staying well. Dr. Flores, thank you again. And we look forward to your continuing involvement in this webinar series. The next invitation will be for December, and we will be sending that out under separate cover.
Thank you very much, Irina. Thank you, everyone.